There we go. There it is. Hotep family. What's going on, community Grand Rising? It is me, your bald wonder, Reverend Dr. Philippe Jacques Matthews, a.k.a. the Metaphysical Morpheus. Let's get it on and popping, family. Uh-oh, what did I miss? Oh, there we go. Here we go.
Something happened to black people. Nothing is wrong with black people. Something happened to black people.
African phenomenologist, comedic scientist, digital with creation, metamorphosis, epigenetics, digenomics, brain frequency of oneness, FBA, no religion, I'm a vision. Nothing is wrong with black people. Something happened to black people.
Yes, yes, yes. That's how you do a show right there. That's how it's done. All right, family. So guess what? You know now. It's that time. It is that time. It is that place. It is time for the man with the plan to put the black history in your hand. He stands 6'3", 200 and something. And when second frequency shows up, they start running when they see this man. It is the one. It is the only. Dr. Clyde Winters.
What up, though? What up, though?
What's going on, Baba? How you feeling?
It's a beautiful day here in Chicago. We had a little tinge of fall weather. It's a little cool, but sun shining, you know. But it's kind of a little depressing because, you know, many Chicago, black Chicagoans are upset. You know, Foundation of Black
America. Why is that? What's going on?
Well, they're upset because, you know, Chicago is supposed to be a city that's supposed to welcome immigrants. And what's happening is that all these immigrants are coming up to Chicago. They're being sent up there from Florida and from Texas. Mm-hmm. And they got nowhere to put them.
Mm-hmm.
And since there's
a housing shortage?
No, the fact is this is that... They're just coming up there and they're trying to get these immigrants, you know, a free place to stay. See, okay. They're illegal. They're illegal in the first damn place, but they don't call them illegal immigrants anymore. They call them migrants. Migrants.
Okay.
They got these thousands of people. And so what it is that they're trying to find somewhere to put them. And they've been trying to mainly put them in the black neighborhoods. You know, they put a few in, they took over an armory in a white community on the north side, but the majority of them are being put in the black community. So black people are upset because they're saying, mm-hmm. What about us? Mm-hmm. They're saying, what about us? What about the homeless? You're not finding any place for the homeless to stay.
Right, right.
And so they had a big thing last night because they want to take this hotel. And they want to put in there all these immigrants because, see, what's happening is that many of the immigrants in Chicago, they don't have anywhere to put them, so they've been staying at the police stations.
Mm.
Oh, yeah, so the police, the lobbies of the police station are really crowded, you know, and because all these people have moved in there and they're sleeping on the floor, you know, and it's really nasty in there, you know. So they want to put them in this hotel.
Yeah, it's a police station. Yeah, you think?
Yeah. And so then, they make them get out every morning, but then they come back every night. And so then they want to put them in this hotel. And if that's not bad enough, the governor, Prixer, and the mayor, Johnson, they want to make it possible for them to get permits, work permits. You know, and that's
whoa, really?
Yeah, they want them to get work permits immediately so they can fill the service.
The labor force.
Yeah, mm-hmm. the service industry, because in Chicago, a lot of people have been protesting, and I think they even had some strikes last year. A lot of some of the hotel workers because they weren't getting paid that much money.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have that many hotel workers, or hospitality workers. So they want to give the immigrants give them a work permit so they can go to work. But you know, that's not really fair because Foundation of Black Americans got the highest unemployment rate in the country. see, whereas only 3.1% of the unemployed are white, 4.1% are black, but 4.1% are Hispanic, but as many as 6% of the black population is unemployed. And then in the state of Illinois, the unemployment rate in the state of Illinois is 10 out of every 100 black people is unemployed.
Mm.
10 out of every 100 black people unemployed. If you're going to give them permits to go in up and take those jobs, what about the black people? So the black people, they're really upset. They get mad. I really think somebody should. I think somebody should try to put a bill on the next election. And in that bill, we should start to vote if we really want to keep making Chicago a city to welcome immigrants. I think it should be put on the ballot, and I think people should have a right to say, because like they said, they don't know what these Venezuelans, Guatemalans, they don't know if they crooks. You know, they stole a lot. They were stealing a lot of the mufflers on the South Side. The last immigrant groups that they put in there, robbing people, beating up. Up in New York City, a lot of the immigrants are prostituting the women,
mm-hmm.
at the hotels. Mm-hmm. A lot of these Guatemalans, Venezuelans. You know, they selling drugs.
Well, you know why, right?
Uh-huh.
Poor people don't have a choice. They have to survive. And when you're poor, crime, or what's denoted as crime, is your only way out. The reason we sell drugs, the reason we have prostitution in our communities, we don't have jobs.
But
if we had jobs, we would. If we had an opportunity, we would not need to do those things to be able to feed ourselves and feed our family.
Let me tell
and
you.
That goes across the board worldwide. Now, when you mix those two elements together in terms of first frequency versus a second frequency or Eurasians, now you have another divide and conquer strategy. This is the same thing that Biden was doing with the elite Eurasians and Hispanics.
Yeah.
So they're overpowering, and if you saw a lot of the black scholars and principals and stuff are losing their jobs, and the ones with the latinx with the PhDs or whatever and the education master's degree, they're getting their jobs.
Yeah.
This is the same thing, but it's for the lower economic strata.
Yeah, but see, this is what it is that they did a study. And they found that, you know, the average illegal Chinese immigrant to California, this was on TV a couple of months ago, they're spending as much as $8,000. They go on the internet and find out the route that they should follow. The average immigrant from Guatemala and Venezuela, they leave with $3,000. They don't come up here broke.
Mm-hmm.
They don't come up here broke. Mm-hmm. Yeah, after they get here. And, you know, like they had this one lady on I saw on TV on Channel 9, WGN.
But let me ask you this, though.
Go ahead.
The path for an Asian is different than the path for a Hispanic.
Yeah, but as I told
and
you.
And a latinx.
But as I told you.
The Asian gets access and... Look at the person. Look at the axiology. Person to the group.
Yeah, but the Venezuelans and the Guatemalans, they come over here. The people save up at least $3,000.
Mm-hmm.
They had to pay people to get over here. They had
Absolutely.
To pay people. They had to pay Absolutely. People. They had to pay people to even lead them through the jungles. See,
right.
See, the whole point is this: is that as a foundation.
But the other part of that, beloved, is what happens. $3,000 in America, in a city like Chicago or any city, in other than a really, really poor. What are you going to do? You know, that $3,000 is going to run out relatively quickly.
Why don't they send them back? They should send them back home. No, this is it. I'm getting pissed off. I'm tired. My father back in 19.
No, I'm in agreement with you. I'm just looking at all of the the situations of how they this second frequency system is manipulating, because unfortunately the poor blacks of Chicago or Compton or whatever city it is, they don't give a F about them. They don't give a fuck.
They don't.
Right? Now, one of the reasons why, you know, as you know, I'm doing this, I'm getting ready to release this book, is to give, before I do the big book, is to give our people an unfair advantage.
Yeah.
And to be able to access information that and how to access the information, the how to, so they can get a leg up, because part of this is the extinction protocol that Dr. Joy was talking about. They told me 10 years ago. They want to get rid of FBAs. They don't want anybody that can come back and claim their land and tell their history. They don't want us to do that.
Yeah.
So okay. This is, so you swap out one for the other. And yeah, this shit is not right. Now, I know some people saying, I hate to say Donald Trump is right. Now, are all of them bad? I don't think so. But are all of them good? No. They can't be, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but you're absolutely correct, and your discussion is apropos. But the fact remains, they always been trying to get rid of us. You know, yes. In 1969, my father was, you know, used to do construction, and this Irish guy, he said, my father said, "Why are we getting some rights?" And the Irish guy told him, "Nobi." He said, "Nobi, I'm gonna tell you something." My father's name was Zenobi, and so he said, "Nobi, I'm gonna tell you something." Is that? They still going to find a way to keep you from getting your shit. And that's what it is. But the whole point is this, is that it's the only reason we're still here is because of Obama. Do you know that it's 300,000 people unemployed in the United States? 300,000.
Wow.
And out of that 300,000 people, you know, these are the people who go into the unemployment office to get a check.
Right.
Out of this 300,000 people who are unemployed, 267,000 are foundational Black Americans.
Wow.
267,000.
Wow.
Those are the statistics up to July. You see?
Wow. That's crazy, Baba.
It is crazy because, see, the whole point is that. So why should we? And that's the beauty. That's what I love about being in Chicago, is that in Chicago, we don't take the shit face value. In New York, because of the fact that New York is mainly full of you know, immigrants like from the Caribbean and Africa and places like that, they're not speaking up. But in Chicago, foundational Black Americans are speaking up. It's not that we don't like immigrants. It's not that we're against immigration. But the whole point is that. What about us? We want something. Do you know?
Absolutely.
Nothing is wrong with Black people. Something happened to us. And then that's
and is happening to us. It's not past tense. It's current.
It is.
Yes. And they have a plan of annihilating us in the future.
Yeah.
We have to be. We have to get ahead of that. That's why we do what we do.
And see that's what really upset a lot of second frequency. See that Montgomery thing upset a lot of white people.
Scared the ish out of them, didn't it?
Right, because they really think that we're waiting around for them to come and kick our ass. They really believe that the entire Black community is they clone Tyrone. No. The entire Black community is not ghetto. The entire Black community is not a community that is full of just people wanting to be drug dealers.
And I know people who live in the ghetto, and they ain't ghetto. They just don't have the finances to get out, but they ain't ghetto.
They ain't ghetto. But see, the whole point is that they've been able, in a sense, to hire all these people, like most of the rappers. Most of the rappers today,
not a rapper.
Just about all the rappers are Caribbean and African. Sukiyana.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, Rihanna. You know,
Stacey Red, you know, Cardi B. They're not even foundational Black Americans.
Right,
and then most of the mumble rappers that be trying to talk like they from the South, they all Caribbeans and Africans. These people so they're trying to brand that as our culture. That's one of the reasons, if you notice, when they talk about the history of hip hop, they're not talking about the hip hop artists that came from California. They're not talking about the hip hop artists that came from Atlanta, Cambridge, Chicago,
New York. Yep.
All they talk about is New York, and then they try to act like it was the Caribbeans and Caribbean and the Latinos who made hip hop. See, everything is just a program. Just like they had a thing the other week, talking about now they want to try to promote, in a sense, African beat or something. You know, African beat, because they want to make that the new thing. See, we need some people. See, our problem is this. You know, we do not have any, you know, record companies. We need somebody. Hey, people, send Yoshimada $1 million.
we need a new Berry Gordy up in this.
We need a new Berry Gordy. Yoshimada could be that guy. See?
Yeah.
The whole point is this, is that they, you know, they bought all the black distribution companies, the few that existed.
Yeah.
All the black musical things. They bought those. This leads right into what is really happening, is that shooting in Jacksonville, Florida. That shooting in Jacksonville, Florida is further evidence of what you're talking about, and what Joy DeGruy told you, is how they want to get rid of us.
Absolutely. 100%. 100%. Yeah, if we don't, now, you know, here's the other rub. If we don't wake up and realize what is happening and listen to select scholars and what have you, and giving us a path out, you're complicit in your own annihilation.
Yeah.
You know, the way to, they have perfected how to make a group of people irrelevant, because you're so busy and worried trying to eat and survive, you don't have the time or the bandwidth to think. And if you do have time to think, you're asking all the wrong questions, because now you're asking questions that's based on surviving versus questions which keeps you in a loop and on a treadmill, versus asking questions that make you thrive and move forward.
And see,
that's what we're dealing with here.
Yeah, and see, that's one of the reasons why now is that, okay, when you really read that case that the Asians did, when the Asians were fighting against affirmative action, they weren't really fighting against affirmative action, black affirmative action. If you really read, in a sense, the case, they were really trying to fight against white people being accepted into these elite universities with lower grades than them.
Right.
But they flipped the script, and they made it against affirmative action. But affirmative action, it didn't really affect us, because the only people, see, those people, and I'm not going to say, you know who those people are. Those people, they like to make a joke out of us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The way those people make a joke out of us is they give us something and then they flip the script. For example, although in a sense they made all this affirmative action for black people to get into universities, they flipped it and then they just started bringing in Caribbeans and people from Africa, and even putting Indians, black Indians from India, East India, letting them get our scholarships. And so then that's why when they ruled against affirmative action, black people said, who don't give a damn? I know, you know, they I didn't go to school off affirmative action. They still
look at all of the, I mean, I forgot the week that it happened, but it was like over 10, maybe close to 20 principals of schools were completely fired and let go.
Yeah, well, see, that's because the Europeans, so you had to understand, is that in the Republican states, they not only want to use that decision to get rid of black people that go to university. They're trying to use that decision to get across the board, get across the board, in a sense, you know, black people being in the employment theater. But see, in the employment theater, you got two types of black people. See, one of the things that allowed us in a sense to become middle class is that we became middle class mainly because of the fact is that we were being hired for public jobs, federal and local jobs in government. You see, that's one of the reasons why, in a sense. And then those people that didn't get jobs because of the fact that they worked for the federal government or the city governments, they got jobs in some of the service industries. And so that allowed us to migrate into it. And so what the Europeans want to do, what the white supremacists want to do, especially in the South, is they want to move black people out of those so-called affirmative action jobs. And so that's one of the reasons why they fired principals and teachers, because that's how many black people are coming up. But see, most of us are not working in those corporations anyway. So in reality, they're gonna fail, because see, the thing is that in many other government jobs that black people had, like I was a teacher, because I was a teacher, that was in a sense a city job.
Mm-hmm.
And because it was a city job, we had a good union. Even though they did fire a lot of black teachers when Rahm Emanuel closed the schools, but the point is black schools. But the thing is, this is that we still had that ability. And so what they're trying to do now is they're trying to remove black people from who got jobs through affirmative action. But I mean, it's not going to work, because most of us don't work for corporations. Most of us don't work for those big jobs. I mean, that's one of the reasons why they don't want our kids to be educated. And they don't want our kids to be educated. And that's the really good thing about what you're doing. Your plan, your idea about getting, you talked last week about your ideas about spreading the knowledge about affirmative action to get black people an advantage. You brought it up last week on the show.
Yeah, an unfair academic advantage, absolutely.
Right. And so it's about 20, I think they said some around 20 million people. You know, either 400, I think it's 20 million people, 400,000 homes now are homeschooling their kids.
That's right. That's right.
I don't know the exact statistics for black people, but that's a lot of people.
And they absolutely
need, you know, and
they
so
need that, and they need an unfair advantage, because we're in an unfair situation and have been. It's never been fair.
Right.
So now it's time to in a real sense, let's just use AMA intelligence to penetrate their artificial intelligence, and let's get it on and popping, family.
Yeah.
So we'll talk about that maybe next week, because I think the book is going to be out maybe this weekend, and then we'll see what the timing is, and then we'll present it to the community. Maybe next week if we have time.
Yeah, well, let me know. What we'll do is we may just do a show. What do you think? Do a show? I'm sorry, family. We're working on a show now.
Yeah, maybe, we that's what we do. We always sit down and talk. Well, let's talk about that's what we do.
Homeschooling.
Yeah, we'll talk about it, because one of the things that is missing from the black community. And we saw this, or I saw this, but I think we all saw it. You know, 2020 was a reset, and it was a planned demic. And what it did was...
Will you say that again?
A planned demic.
All right,
It wasn't a pandemic. It was a planned demic. And one of the pieces that they made sure of is that our B1 babies were not able to get educated.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying this about all parents, but I do know, like, my parents were illiterate. They were fighting and fleeing from Jim Crow. They had fourth grade education. So they couldn't help me with fractions and complex math and algebra and all that. They couldn't help me. And there are parents that was in this situation in 2020 that their children, they couldn't do anything. They couldn't help their children. They wanted to. Nobody wants to not help their child with, you know, English, math, science, and what have you. If you don't have those skill sets and you didn't get educated, that's why you're sending your kid, busting your ass right now. to send your kid to get educated. But what happens when the education system shuts down and stops your child and causes your child to have planned arrested development? So I figured out a way, looking at the landscape of technology, the landscape of AI, the landscape of AMA intelligence, and I figured out, I think, a way for us to be able to collapse time, and so that we will be able to save our black babies, we will be able to save ourselves by saving our B1 babies. And I'm looking forward to the response from the community. Now, I've done a test run, as you know, with a select small group. And everybody has told me, from all different economic levels and academic levels, that this is a game changer. This is a departure from anything that we've seen before in the B1 community. So if that is the case, then this is what we're going to be presenting to the community, hopefully, if everything goes the correct way, hopefully next week.
Yeah, well, that sounds good. Because you talked to me about doing a curriculum. If I can get it done, I'll bring it up then. But whatever, we'll talk about that next week. You have to let me know let me know if you're going to have a book ready.
I'll let you know. Yeah, we're running tests right now on it and everything, and we're seeing, I'm a strategist. I've been studying this since 2018, but I have studied what was that commercial that said, "We will sell no wine before it's time"? What was that drink? I forgot the drink. Family, y'all might know it. What's up, cool dude? I haven't seen cool dude in a minute. What's going on, bro?
Wine company.
Yeah, it was a wine company. "We will sell no wine before it's time." Might have been Seagram's. Huh?
The Gallows? I don't know, because that's what the wine that has used to drink when I was growing up. Bring me the Gallows, baby!
Was it Wild Irish Rose? No, I don't know. How does Real Shock know about that? Anyway, I don't...
When I was in college, I never drank because my father drank. That's all the brothers drank when I was at University of Illinois.
OG Gorilla. Yes, indeed. Y'all know about that. And I smoke good cigars. My father's had Black and Mild. Y'all know about Black and Mild? Y'all don't know nothing if y'all don't know about a Black and Mild. Y'all don't know nothing.
Everybody's smoked that, man. I don't know if I should say this. I'm not going to say it. I was going to talk about one of my sons,
Oh, no, you don't want him coming over there. No.
He's changed now. I'm not going to name who it was, but who I'm talking about. So one day, he had moved. He had lived on the west side for a while. So one day he drove over to the house. I happened to be sitting on the front porch. I went over there, man. His car was full of smoke. What the hell is this? You know what it was. But anyway,
he was getting that ganja, man.
Yeah, ganja, man. He don't do it anymore since he married, got kids, and all that type of stuff. But the thing is that we do need this because I had taught during the pandemic, and mm-hmm. I was teaching special ed.
Yes.
And so then I noticed.
How long did you teach special ed, Baba?
Huh?
How long did you teach special ed?
I taught special ed what? The last 10 years, I taught for 22 years at Bennett. So I'd say about 8 of those years I taught special ed.
Wow.
Yeah, because see what happened is that I was certified to teach upper grade social studies.
Okay.
But then you had to be certified in every field. And although I was certified in every field, my principal, she wanted me to teach special ed because she wanted to try to get our kids in special ed, get their scores up.
Sure.
So I taught special ed. And, last week they talked about the fact that the greatest basketball player today, LeBron James.
Uh-huh.
He talked about that at school. how you know, most of the teachers at his school are Beckys, but none of the people at his school are passing the state and district tests. And so it is so easy. Because I taught sixth grade and eighth grade for about 15 years at Bennett. And none of my kids ever had to be retained in sixth grade, because I knew how in a sense to pass those tests. The way you pass the test is, number one, listen to me, our family, listen to me. Number one, you had to, when at the beginning of the term, I would always tell my kids, you're going to pass the Iowa test. Later it became, in a sense, the state test. I said, you're going to pass. I told them every day, if you don't pass, I'm going to whoop your ass.
I love it. That's a teacher that loves their babies. Yes.
And back then they didn't have no phones, you know.
Yeah, they couldn't tell nobody.
That's right.
You weren't on social media.
If I tell anybody, I'm going to whoop your ass, I'm going to deny it. And you have no proof. Now when they come to class, you want to take their phones. But back then, you know, no phones.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
So number one, you tell them that they can pass the test. Then number two, what we would do is that, At my school was never on probation until my principal died. I love her so much. My wife used to say, if I die, you can marry her. Well, she died first. But anyway, she said, I don't care about, she said, those other women, but you can marry Mrs. Ellis. But Mrs. Ellis died first. But what we did is, I brought to the school, what, about $300,000 in grants. So, okay. You know, she respected me. So I told her what we would do is this. I said, we'll teach the regular program. But then in January, we had to spend at least an hour a day to teach kids how to take the test. I didn't say teach them what's on the test, because we don't know what's on the test.
Right.
But I said, you teach the kids how to take the test. And if you teach the kids how to take the test, then when the test comes, they're going to pass the test.
Right.
So then we avoided our school being on probation until after my principal died. And then we had some new principals. And the new principals came in, they belonged to a certain sorority, AKA, oh, I'm sorry. But anyway, they came in.
The boule, the bourgeoisie.
Right, the boule, you know, sisters, not all of them, I think, are like that. And so then when the new principal came in, I said, well, it's January. We had to take out the practice books to teach the kids. You know what this witch did?
What?
She threw away thousands of tests, of practice test books. Threw them all away.
Wow.
Threw them all away. Well, see, they were jealous because my principal, Mrs. Ellis, she was the highest paid principal on the South Side, highest paid principal, and our school was never on probation because she had me.
Wow.
But anyway, so they hated us so much, but then that's the whole problem. The whole problem is that you got these Beckys, or you got these sorority girls who think they know everything, and they don't understand practice makes perfect is what grandma said.
That's right.
Grandma was right. Practice makes perfect. And so that's why if we do this show next week, family, we're going to tell you how to set up your homeschooling program where you can get your kids ready. Because remember, the reason that I could tell the kids, excuse me, that they were going to pass the test was because of the fact is that you're dealing with children who have 300,000 years of knowledge. You're dealing with kids who can access the Akashic records at any time.
Absolutely. Because they're young, they're babies, they don't have the racial battle fatigue that you have. their minds are completely fresh. They haven't been traumatized to the point where they've slowed down or they have given up because they're trying to figure out how to survive.
Right.
This is the time to get our black B1 babies ready. Because here's the other thing. You can right now, get a bachelor's or a master's degree and you are not going to find a job.
Yeah. And black women are the most highly educated people on the planet, and a lot of them being evicted from homes, and they got masters and PhDs.
They are on Instagram showing their booty. I mean, I know some of them that have master's degrees. They can't find they can't find employment. So there's a way to get around this, and this is what we have to understand is that this is, as somebody, I think it was Darlene, said, I forgot who it was, Darlene or Brother Crates, it's design. This is another plandemic. It's planned this way. So we have to use AMA intelligence, not artificial intelligence in a sense. Yeah, the intelligence is artificial, but if we use AMA intelligence to overwrite the artificial intelligence, we win. We use their game against them.
A good example is that Uncle Tom Fanny Willis, I think it is, in Atlanta. You know, they established all these laws to prosecute people. You know, using the RICO law, and now Fanny Willis, she's using the RICO law that they wanted to use against black people, that she used to attack a lot of black rappers. Now she's using that against that demigod, Trump.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See? So see, like you said.
That's it. Use their own stuff against them. Use their own laws.
It always happens.
That's how you do it.
It always happens.
This is why we always talk about the spook that sat by the door.
Right.
He was getting intelligence, intel. He was downloading. You know what your enemy is doing, and you know what your enemy is doing, what they're thinking, then you know how to defeat them. You know how to counter it.
Right.
You are now in a position of power, not in a position where you have to bend over.
Yeah. Or take the knee. Or bend the knee.
Or bend the knee. Yeah.
Just like all these years, these people have said, we don't want black people to do nothing. Black people can't do nothing. And now you notice America's in a complete decline because of the fact that there's no innovation. We always did the scientific innovation in America.
That's right.
You know, they've been waiting for the scientific innovation to come from the universities. And the only scientific innovation that came from the university was what? The atomic bomb.
Yep.
Outside of that, what have university graduates done?
Nothing.
See, we made this country. And now the country's going down because they wanna try to find a way to keep us out. But see, as you can see, they follow all these other people and their dictates and their university degrees, and they're going nowhere. They're going nowhere. Look at this. Should I brag? Yeah, I'm gonna brag.
Please
look at all these people from they graduate from Temple University every year with a PhD in black studies.
Mm-hmm.
And now if you compare those people that graduate from Temple with PhDs in black studies, if you compare them, I've only had three classes. I'm into my fourth class.
Mm-hmm.
And if you compare the research that you guys are doing after being in my class compared to the people from Temple University getting a PhD.
There's no comparison.
There's no comparison because they ain't doing it.
No, I can vouch for your you're not bragging. Bragging is when you're talking about shit that you didn't do. You did this shit. So let me just let me understand and you help me with this is that I only have, I don't know, four or five papers published, but I have more papers published than many of these PhDs who have graduated from these Ivy League schools.
Yeah.
Right. So what are you doing? What, you know, what's, what, and that was coming from Clyde's class.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? Teaching me how to do research. Now, there's a group of us, and I was part of that group. There's a group of us that was just scared on a multiple levels of taking our paper, writing our paper, and then publishing our paper. One, some of us was afraid of, you know, oh, I don't know how to write well or spell well or create my sentence syntax correctly. Okay, that's legitimate. Then we have another group that's like, well, I don't want to freaking let Dr. Clyde Winters down. That's his name. I don't want to come out with some BS. The other side is like, there's another group that's like, I'm scared that I'm going to fail again. You know, I've done it. And so, again, what I've done is I, because I'm teaching some of the researchers this process, that out the gate, your first paper is going to look like it was written by a Harvard professor. It's going to look, so let go of all of your fears. And I used to use this quote. I haven't used it. I don't even know if I used it on this show ever. But the question you have to ask yourself, community, what fear is keeping me here? Write that down. What fear is keeping me here? And I'm guilty as charged, because I was afraid, because I had, you know, achieved, in a sense, the impossible. I didn't get my GED until I was 29. Somewhere in that, maybe a little earlier. Now, I learned how to drive when I was 29. I think I got my GED when I was 26 or something like that. But still, 26, I got my GED. All right, now, it's taken me this long to figure out that I was smart all along. I wasn't functionally illiterate. I was functioning in an illiterate zip code, right? So when you're in, whatever you are around is what you become. So I had to separate myself from the community that was functionally and socially illiterate. And then here we are years later, I got a PhD. But it's not just a PhD, or what, Doc, you call ABD, all but the dissertation. So I got the dissertation, got the PhD, but there's another level. You got the PhD, but how does your work epigenetically change the world and affect children and adults that you'll never meet? You have to publish. You have to publish books. You have to publish papers. That's how you become immortal. That's how you become an ancestor. That's how you become remembered. Now, I've said this before, Doc, on the platform, and I'm going to say it again. As you and all the community members watching know, I've interviewed everyone for the last 10, 15 years. I know them all. No scholar is duplicating and replicating himself or herself other than you. You're the only one that is teaching the teacher, that's training the trainer. You are creating the many me's that are, and you're doing it where you say, hey, no. I don't want you to just publish papers on the stuff that I like and the stuff that I do. I want you to publish you. What do you like? What do you want to research? What information do you want to bring to the world and to the community? Nobody is doing that shit. No one. And this is, so it's incumbent upon us, community, to get behind this man and understand that this is what Black excellence looks like. Back in Africa, ancient times, this is what we call a griot or a joli. This is what it looks like. This is how you pass on from one generation to the next. You have Clyde Winter's babies. Just as I talk about Reverend Dr. Johnny Coleman, I'm a Dr. Johnny Coleman baby. Guess what? I'm a Clyde Winter's baby. Because he's given birth to me to be able, I can research anything, family. I can research and find out anything. I can write about anything. And I can dissect and decipher bad research from good research. That gives us an unfair advantage. But I'm not the only one. I want all of us, past graduates of the class, current people in the class, to do the same thing. And this is why we, so no, Doc, it ain't bragging, It's just telling it like a T-I-T-S.
Yes. But like I said, I'm so, the most important thing is this family to understand is that this is why, you know, the work that the Reverend Dr. Matthews has done with artificial intelligence and that book that he's coming out with, I've read it already. And it's
the forward. Thank you for again. Thank you, Anna. I'm going to thank you more when we do the show, but you have no idea what that meant for me.
Thank you very much. But the point is that it's parent friendly. It's parent friendly. And because it's parent friendly, it's a book that you're going to be able to use. See, I'm going to tell you, the scariest thing in the world is to homeschool your kids.
Yeah. And we were forced in the pandemic to do it. And that's when we saw the dichotomy. We're like, shit, I'm not ready for this. I'm not prepared.
And a lot of parents, they ran to YouTube. And I mean, they said, oh, this is how it's done. But there's nothing on YouTube that tell you how to start your own homeschool. There's nothing on YouTube about that. But I want you, this is it. You listen, you tell your friends, and you return next week, and we're going to give you the program. We're going to give you the biz. Well, if I can't get it done, I'll be sick that week. But
you ain't right.
And I'm going to tell you that I'm sick because Reverend Dr. Matthews, it was his mistake. It's always his mistake.
You got to blame it on me. You got to blame it on somebody. You got to blame it on somebody. Why not blame it on you? Most people blame it on the rain or blame it on the alcohol. No, blame it on Rev Shock.
You know, I don't have any pets. I can't blame it on the dog. Okay. Have to be you guys. But anyway, let's get started with the presentation. So that we're going to talk about the Sioux civilization.
And absolutely.
The thing is that the Sioux civilization is a civilization that I just found out about because see. You know, I used to have this brother, he'd always send me an email saying, Dr. Winters, what about the Zhang civilization? I said, I'm sorry, I don't know about no Zhang civilization.
Yeah, I think I remember seeing him in the chat about that. Yeah.
And they came back to me about the Zhang, but that they might be talking about the Jan civilization of East Africa, but I don't know. They said Zhang.
But the point
is that what I'm going to do now, I'm going to tell you about a civilization that I just discovered. I didn't know anything about this civilization about 4 years ago, but mm-hmm. I found this out through research. See, this the whole point is that we've been so conditioned that the white man knows everything. Second frequency knows the whole world. They know. No, they don't. See,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to repeat to you again. Why is it that my students are successful? Why mm-hmm. is it that my students are making an important imprint? And I'm going to tell you why. Do you know that the giants in Egyptology, Breasted, Petri, Champollion, who deciphered the, none of those people went to college?
Yes.
None of those people studied Egyptology, they were interested. And see, that's what's making my students contribute so much to Afrocentrism, contribute so much our history. I have to talk about Sister Shanice.
She's on here too. What's up, Sister Shanice?
And the reason I bring up Sister Shanice is that this woman, she don't have to do what she do, but this woman took the time and her time is valuable. She has a husband to take care of. And I can tell you, my wife
and
had
kids.
To take care of my dumb ass because I needed her to take care of me. So Sister Denise has a husband. She has a child. People are demanding stuff from her, but she took the time to write a book about King Offa. And not only did she write a book about King Offa, she included in it a short history of the Barada Knights.
And she published a paper.
She's published a paper. She got some other papers too. But she ain't right. even... She ain't even talked about her survey yet, you know.
Yep, that's coming.
It's coming. But the thing is this, she wrote that book and then she wrote an entire history so that the children the black children in Britain can see their real history, know who they are. And that's wonderful because, see, Sister Shanice, instead of her in a sense saying that she was going to be selfish, she took the time to share with her people in Britain their history. Right. And she took the time, and I have to keep commending her on that.
Right.
Because
right.
You do not know. You do not know. It is hard. It is hard for somebody to take that weight on her. You know,
Yeah, it is.
Another one was Marie Charles. But see, what makes it so beautiful is that Shanice wrote her book. She wrote a book in a plain English so that anybody with a fifth grade reading ability, right, and that says about everybody, can read her book and understand her book and find pride in themselves. And this is what we need. This is what we need in ourselves. We need other people. We need, what's the brother name? The brother Norway. We need your ass to do some stuff about the blacks in Norway.
Yeah.
Do the real history of the Danes.
Yeah.
I mean, really, do the real history of the Danes.
We really do.
You know, Marie Charles has a lot of stuff in her book, Missing Faces in Teaching, MFIT.
MFIT, Missing Faces in Training.
Missing Faces in Teaching,
yes.
A lot on the Danes, you see.
Yep.
We need this stuff out there, but again, we had to get it started. I just learned about the Sioux. I'm going to hurry up and get into this, and so let's get started.
All right, Doc. Let me pull it up on the screen. Let's go full screen, and there we go. I'm going to mute myself, and you take it away, Doc.
Okay. The Sioux Empire, a secret empire of old Africa. Yes, this is a secret empire because, see, a lot of people, they get things mixed up. They don't know that the history of Egypt is much more complicated than the Europeans tell you. Because, see, as I've tried to say, and we did a show on this a couple of years ago, because we're coming up to the end of 2 years doing this program, we've only missed, and I'm so proud to say this, that out of the past 2 years, we've only missed three shows. Only three shows.
How about that?
Every week.
We get good attendance from the community. We're going to get a certificate. Somebody going to give us a certificate.
I'm going to be like the little kids. I want a sticker.
I want a sticker. That's right.
But anyway.
I love it.
We've been doing this for the past 2 years. Every Thursday, you've been able to come here to this channel, come into this bad channel, this bad place, and get this knowledge and information. But see, there's so much about ancient Egyptian history that we don't know. And the reason we don't know is that all these black people getting their PhDs at Temple University, they're getting them at maybe Harvard, but they're not learning ish because they don't do the research.
You gotta say it the right way, like you normally say it, Harvard.
You know, they get their PhD from Harvard. And although they have automatic entry into the upper elites, they don't know what's going on because all they do is they read the material did by people like you, family. Breasted, he wasn't no damn expert on Egyptology. He learned hieroglyphics, then he traveled to Egypt, and then he became the expert. You can become an expert in anything too. Stop. Stop thinking that the only way that you can contribute to our history, contribute to teaching us about who we are, you had to go and get a PhD or a degree from a university. Please join my Patreon. You can go to my Patreon to see the slides. I want to thank those people who joined my Patreon in the past week. And I also want you to join Dr. Matthews' Patreon because, see, Dr. Matthews, he gives you a lot of good stuff in his Patreon. And you need to be a member of his Patreon. You see, that supports us in getting books, getting materials. You know, the average book now costs, not my books, but the average book costs about $49, $50, $60. Do you know that the average research paper, there's some research papers that are published in free, but most of them you have to pay as much as $39 or $49 just to have a couple of articles, just to have a couple of hours to read a paper before they take it offline. And you can't print it, so you can't make a copy of it. So we do need your support in Patreon. you know, and I also, a lot of you also send me money on my Cash App. I want to thank you for sending me the money on my Cash App. And if I haven't told you that before, I want to thank you. But join my Patreon, and you'll see the slides on my Patreon. Go to my YouTube channel, Clyde Winters Afrocentric History Site. I've got hundreds of videos there. You know, so you go there, subscribe, and you can hear about my upcoming lives. I'm going to do a live broadcast later in September. And that live broadcast, I'm going to tell you, a lot of people, they say that the Egyptians were in the Grand Canyon. But they say there's no proof, and that there's no way that you can prove Egyptians were in the Grand Canyon, because we don't have the artifacts, because the Smithsonian Institute, they're hiding the artifacts. But I'm going to show you that through my research, that I can prove that from their description of the materials, that it had to be the Egyptians who did it. But you got to wait and see. Maybe in a couple of weeks, I'm going to do that that live broadcast. It'll be on a Sunday. And I usually do my live broadcast on Sunday around 3 p.m. The reason I do it around 3 p.m., I know it's early for many of you, but that's about early evening, and that's around 7, 8 o'clock overseas. And so I want to make sure that the people who belong to my Patreon, who live in Europe, can see the program and you know, have great access to it. You can find me on Twitter at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. You can order my books at Amazon.com. Please support me, support my books, get these books, give them to your children, let them learn and know who they are. Be one, Black first. FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. Yes, yes, yes. We were over here before the European got here. We've been here for thousands of years. Thousands of years. The earliest skeletal remains are the Antic man. The Antic baby, I mean. But the Antic baby that dates back to 12,000 BC. This baby carried the R1Y chromosome. And let me tell you something. Today, 22%, I repeat, 22% of foundational Black Americans carry the R1Y chromosome. What does this matter, family? Dr. Winters, why are you bringing this issue up? But the fact is that if Anzac baby carried the Y chromosome R1 haplogroup, and 22% of foundational Black Americans carry R1 today, that means that one-fourth of the foundational Black, one-fifth of the foundational Black American population, no, one-fourth of the foundational Black Americans in this country, their ancestry goes back 12,000 years. 12,000 years, baby. That tells you who we are, you see. We're FBA all the way. We are Aboriginal Black Indigenous people native to the United States. FBA ancestry is African. FBA heritage depend on the tribal origins and presence of various states. Some of us call ourselves Moors, Hebrews, Choctaw, Cherokee, Blackfeet, Christian, Catholic, Protestant, and yet these are just heritages. These are just our heritages, baby. Our ancestry is African because that's where our greatest ancestors came from. In fact, you know, they found evidence that the first Africans came to the Americas 100,000 years ago. That's who we are. Aboriginal FBA were the first slaves. Yes, our Black Indian brothers, my ancestors who were Choctaw, they were enslavers, but a lot of them were sold as slaves too, because we were dumb. We were dumb because the fact is that we felt in the sense that we could sell each other. We didn't recognize each other as being brothers and sisters. We saw you as a different nation, and because you belong to a different nation, you were Cherokee, or you were Ishi, or you were Yushi, or you were Yamasi. Well, we felt that we could sell you because you weren't part of our nation. But the trick was on us. Second Frequency had the last laugh, because while we were selling each other, we were depleting our numbers, and they were increasing their numbers, and eventually they took the land from us. They took our land, but they took our land because they had our help. How did they have our help? We helped them because we spent our time attacking each other, selling each other, instead of, in a sense, being brothers and sisters and loving each other, you see? Yes, we do black on black crime, but white people, they do white on white crime. There's people that get shot in the city of Chicago and other cities by gangbangers. But we can never do what they do. Look at how they had World War II. World War II. During World War II, the Germans, they killed over 34 million Russians. That's not even counting the soldiers and other white people who died. Yes, there's no black on black crime like white on white crime. Identity matters. They use terms to make black FBAs invisible. They call us colored minorities, African Americans. We have to reject all of those so-called identities. The number one African American in the United States is Elon Musk. And he's a billionaire, one of the top billionaires, but he's African American. Why? Because he came from South Africa. Some people will say, Clyde, Dr. Winters, you can't say he's African. Only Africans are black. Well, he claims he's African. He says he came from that nation. But that's why we don't want to be identified as colored minorities or African Americans. Foundational Black American is a more descriptive term for us. It's a better term for us because it tells you who we are. We're the foundation of America. We were here before anybody. We was here before this nation became the United States of America. Over 200,000 foundational Black Americans fought in the Civil War to free themselves. Yes, we fought to free ourselves. You know, they always talk about Lincoln freed the slaves. Lincoln freed the slaves so we could kick white ass. Sis. Well, what have you done wrong? Well, the Union was losing the Civil War. Lincoln needed some real niggas to get out there and kick some ass. And so he allowed 200,000 black soldiers to fight in the Civil War. Another 200,000 black people were the support people who carried the tents, build the camps and stuff. But we kicked ass, sis. We would still be slaves today if it wasn't for my ancestors who fought in the Civil War. Yeah, a few winners from Mississippi, they fought in the war. Yeah, they may have been some of them may have been mulattoes, but what the hell? Them niggas fought! That's why we're free today. FBA culture is American culture. The food, the music, the language, is everything they got from us. Why is it American foods they got from us? Because, see, we used to cook in the kitchens, not only in the North and the South, but also in the North. They had slavery in the North, people. Today they just talk about the slaves that worked on the cotton fields. There were black slaves in the North on those farms. There was black people growing rice. There was black people, Native American, you know, black African Indians and all that, and blacks from Africa. They were working on the tobacco plantations, the rice plantation. Yes. That's how the food's got to be that. The music, and everybody know the music is, the world music is from us. Listen to that jazz music. Listen to that hype music. We're the ones who started the great bands. We're the ones who started, in a sense, having you know, not just in a sense the drums, but we had a brass section. We had, in a sense, the guitar section. We're the ones that made all these beautiful pieces. Listen to some of the shit that the jazz musicians even make today. Listen to what Louis Armstrong did. Look how they used it. Look at how people in the 60s and 70s, the Gap Band, Funkadelics, Look how they use that music. We made the music. And that's why today we dominate music around the world. The roots of NBA culture is cuisine. Our cuisines came from the Three Sisters. And the Three Sisters are the crops that were grown by the Black Indians over here. See? They always want to tell you that there were the five civilized tribes were Mongoloid. And that's a lie. We know the Mongoloid Indians, they were hunters and gatherers. They lived off the buffalo. Yes, they lived off the buffalo. There used to even be buffalo in Georgia and all those other places. You know, but the white man, you know, second frequency killed them off. But it was our Black Indians that began, in a sense, the culture here. And what did we grow? We grew the Three Sisters. That was corn, beans, and squash. And then later, in a sense, you know, as Africans came over here, Africans brought the greens over here from West Africa, collard greens. And then we created the bread of life. And the bread of life came from, in a sense, corn, because the bread of life, in a sense, came from cornmeal when we made our hotcakes. Yes, hotcakes. Hotcakes is the bread of life. You show me an FBA that don't like hot water cornbread or hotcakes, and I show somebody who's a faker. What is the origin of foundational Black American cuisine? We already talked about the Three Sisters: corn, squash, beans, cornmeal. You know, and then beautifully in 1526, they brought some enslaved, the Spanish brought some enslaved people from Haiti in 1526 down to Florida. And these Haitians, they introduced, in a sense, these black enslaved people from Haiti, they introduced the tomatoes. Then West Africans, they introduced collard greens and other greens. And then the Moors. They took chickens to Europe, and it was Columbus who brought the chicken over to the United States. So we had the Three Sisters, we had our chickens. And don't forget, in a sense, if they say Europeans, no, that's a lie, because chickens were first domesticated in Egypt, and Europeans didn't even know about a chicken until the Moors went into Europe. FBA built America before and after Europeans came to the U.S. We cleaned the land. We built the railroads. We built the roads. Yes, Black people. American technological superiority was made by FBA. You see, look at all these inventions we made. This is not even all of them. This is just a minuscule amount. You know, we even made the dry cleaning invention. Today you can't find a nigga with a damn dry cleaning place. You know, they all owned by Asians now, or they owned by white people. We're the ones who started it. See, the only problem we have is that a lot of times we don't have the money. And because we don't have the money, somebody else can come and take our ideas and make even more money. Yes, 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 yes. It was J.D. Metzler who made the shoe machine. You know, that's how we can make shoes today. It wouldn't be any Nikes today made on a mass scale if it wouldn't have been for Max Jaeger. And then, in a sense, we even had people who invented the cars. C.R. Patterson, his son, invented one of the first automobiles. But sadly, we didn't really take hold in the automotive industry, because see, Ford, they found they nigga. And when they went and they found this brother, they found the brother, the Peanut Man. Yes, the Peanut Man. Carver taught Ford how to create the plant, the factory, the automotive assembly line. That's why they call automotive assembly line a plant, because he got it from Carver. Yes, yes, yes. Even the number one automotive company in the United States for many years, they even got their ideas from a Black man. FBA, foundational Black Americans all the way. We also had Charles Drew. And in 1904 to 1950, Charles Drew, he was an American surgeon and professor. And he pioneered the method of storing blood. In fact, he also, in a sense, invented the whole idea about plasma for transfusions. It was during the World War II that many of the soldiers survived and were able, in a sense, to survive many of those massive injuries they got during World War II because of the researcher Charles Drew. Sadly though, he died because he couldn't even get to a hospital to be serviced because there was no black hospital around and the white hospitals refused them. Yes, yes, yes. But look at this great invention. And then what is this? And then the number one invention today, you hear in a sense how President Jim Crow Joe Biden, he's trying to keep in a sense all of these chips from China so that China won't be able in a sense to go to 10G and all that type of El Meso. But all of this, the chips and everything, is made possible because of this brother right here. And this brother right here, in a sense, his name was Boykin. And Mr. Boykin, what he did, he created the transistor. And all of these inventions that are going on today, all these chips that they're talking about, making computers and other electrical instruments working, is because of the development of Otis Boykin. And this was a brother, Foundation of Black America. And see, a lot of people say Foundation of Black Americans don't have a culture. Just because these people are trying to promote ghetto culture like Sukiyana, you know, Sexy Red, Cardi B, and the rest of these foreign people are trying to say that Foundation of Black Americans don't have a culture. We do have a culture. We have a culture. American culture is our culture. And part of our culture is being scientific innovators. This is Mark E. Dean. Mark E. Dean, this brother, he created the first personal computer. What did I say? Mark E. Dean created the first personal computer. Yes, yes. That computer that you're looking at right now, that phone that you're looking at right now, is based on the principles that Mark E. Dean made. And in fact, it was a brother who wrote the program that allowed us to go to the internet today. The original internet was going to be used by the military in case of a nuclear war, and they would be able to communicate, you know, with each other. So the brother wrote the program that allowed all of us, everybody in the world today, can get knowledge from the internet because of the fact that it was a brother who made that program. But it was Mark E. Dean, this brother right here, who created the first personal computer. Stop talking that ish. Don't you dare let nobody carry that Foundation of Black Americans don't have a culture. Whoa! Oh, wait a minute. Henry T. Thomas? Sampson Jr.? Who the hell is this nigga? I'll tell you who he is. He invented the cell phone. Every day you go around, you find people in a sense on that cell phone, clicking it, looking it. Every time you get a free moment, you're trying to see what the mail is. It was Henry T. Thomas who invented the cell phone. Yes, yes, yes. It was a clunky thing originally. Yeah, all the European does is that he takes our inventions and he makes them smaller. He makes them sexier. He makes them prettier. But we made it. Yes, yes, yes. Henry Sampson from Jackson, Mississippi, he invented, in a sense, the cell phone. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. This African rapper, he talking about black people don't have a culture. Yet there he is trying to wear some damn gold teeth in his mouth and wearing a damn gold chain and trying to sing like black people, Foundation of Black Americans. Yet he say we don't have a culture when he's using our culture. Yes, 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 yes. Stop letting people tell you that we don't have a culture. You see, FBA, we are always, in a sense, trying to find ways to make money. You see, we set up so many independent cities like Rosewood, like Black Wall Street, and then they blow them up, they burn them up, they build a railroad through it, because every time they see us trying to make some cash, they try to hold us back. But they can't hold us back because God is always there, and he always finds a way that there's no way that they ever expected black people to still be in America. There's no way they ever expected black people to live in nice homes and not just be stuck in all tore up raggedy tenements. But through the mercy of God, we're more successful today than any time in history. And I guarantee you that every plan every planet that European, every planet that second frequency has to put us down, hold us back. We find a way to overcome. Yes. Yes. Martin Luther King was right in 1963 on the March on Washington when he said that they owed us a check, and the check ended up being insufficient funds. But it don't matter. We still surpassing. We still moving on up. We still creating cities, towns, and villages that we're taking over. We're not all on aid, waiting for food stamps. They're on aid, waiting for food stamps, like they were always the majority. You see? But we fight for success. And with God behind us, who can stop us? Nobody can stop Hama. And then also remember, in a sense, that they took away our heritage. We are the Black Indians, many of us. Just about 65% of us have Indian heritage, Indian ancestry. But what they've done, they've taken away our Indian ancestry, and they've given it to the Mongoloid people. And they let these Mongoloid people go around the country pretending that they're the original founders of civilization in America, and that's a lie. B1 is acknowledging your Black African ancestry, not heritage. What is B1? B1, Black First, is unity with Mod. See, Kim Dijit, Mod. Be Black, B1. Hope that you'll buy my books. They show all the podcasts from the last couple of years. And then I just wrote a new book. And this new book I just wrote is called A History of the Sioux Empire. Kemet, the name of ancient Egypt, was not the only African civilization. 4,000 years ago, there was another great civilization in Africa called Sioux. Although the capital of this empire was centered in the Nile Valley, Sioux extended into Asia. In History of the Sioux Empire, I tell you the history of the Sioux Empire and the Mandi-speaking people who founded the gigantic empire. The term Sioux comes from adding a U to Sioux to make the term plural. Have you ever seen a TV serial that once you looked at it, the first film in the series, you couldn't wait to see the next installment? That happened to me when I first saw Salem Lot on TV. I'll never forget that the thing that hooked me was in Salem Lot, they had all these vampires taking over this town. And then the scene that always sticks out in my mind is when this baby is trying to make the mother let him into the house so he can suck her blood. That is so riveting, and I still remember that thing. Or have you ever read a book that once you began reading it, you couldn't put it down? That was A Man Who Cried, I Am. When I read that book by John A. Williams, I couldn't put it down. I read it from cover to cover. If this has happened to you, you may understand how I became interested in finding out what the Sioux dynasty or civilization was. I had no knowledge that a Sioux empire even existed 3 or 4 years ago. We're often confronted with the imagined reality that Europeans know about everything. We are constantly bombarded with a steady stream of "why didn't I say so?" i.e., the white person says something is, it is so. In other words, in a sense, you know, Europeans are supposed to know everything. At least that's what the white supremacists teach you. This is especially true of history. Europeans have had sway on history writing for the past 200 years. In fact, it was a European who invented the writing of history. Thusly, the writing of history has been the preserve of the European, a hegemony of writing ancient history. That has only been challenged. Yes. The European hegemony on writing ancient history has only been challenged by Blacks in America, FBA, like W. Du Bois, Carter G. Woodson, and J. Rogers, and George Jackson. These people, in a sense, these Black people are the only ones who have ever taken up the mantle of writing ancient history. You don't see any Africans writing ancient history. You don't even see Asians writing ancient history. The only people who fight the European white supremacist hegemony over history is foundational Black Americans. Before the rise of white supremacy, the scholars and savants of the Black world wrote about an important people and events as annals. The definition of annals is Latin annales, or annus, year, are concise historical records in which events are arranged chronologically year by year, although the term is also used loosely for any historical record. Annals can be quite hard to maintain. After all, they store years of work in order. Thusly, when we read about the exploits of Ramses II, we are reading an annal. Yes, an annal. Yes, our ancestors wrote about important events, but it was the European who wrote historical pieces. Wikipedia explains that, and I quote, "History is the systematic study and documentation of the human past. The period of events before the invention of writing systems is considered prehistory. History, quote unquote, is an umbrella term comprising past events, as well as the memory, discovery, collection, organization, presentation, and interpretation of these events," unquote. As a result, we take for granted that if a European tells us about Egyptian history, we can rely on the fact that this history he presents to us is the entire story about this great civilization, Kemet. But is it true? Do we really know the entire story about the past? The answer must be no. The answer is no, because as new records are found and ancient languages are deciphered, our view of historical events may change over time. Although this is true, due to European hegemony of writing history as a feature of white supremacy, we fail to think that there are few, if any, pages of history that have not been uncovered by the almighty European. But this is not true. There's much history that remains a mystery, draped in myths and traditions that are so deeply held in the past that often we can't see what is right in front of our faces. This is true of our knowledge about the civilization called Su. Granted, on the past 40 years of historical research, I have seen many and numerous groups of people mentioned in places around the world called Su. But I never realized that there was a connection among these people that went back to Egypt. Yes, I saw a lot of people I saw in Su. They say Su here, Su there. I said, what? I just took for granted that all these people were separate. But I had to learn that this was untrue. Frankly, I knew that no civilization could have existed in ancient Kemet, because Kemet was a monolithic civilization made of one people speaking a single language, Medinetra. True, the Kamayu or the Kamatu were seemingly frequently engaged in conflicts with the Kushites of Nubia and Lower Egypt, the Hyksos. There could never have been another world empire whose center was situated in Kemet along the Nile River, but I was wrong. There was a great civilization whose satellites extended as far away as East Asia, yet centered in the Nile Valley. This civilization was called Su. It was resurrected in Egypt, Kemet, during the second and immediate period. I refer to this Su empire as the second Su empire, because I believe the first Su empire was founded by the Anu. The first rulers of Kemet and probably the long-lost civilization we call Atlantis were, in a sense, Anu. This Anu civilization flourished around the world, up to and beyond the Younger Dryas, from around 20,000 to 5,000 BC, plus or minus a few thousand years. I discussed some of the inscriptions from this original Su period in my book on the Thinite Writing. Yes, get this book, The Dawn of Writing, Decipherment of the Thinite Dispillow Tablets, and the Göbekli Tepe Pillars. In this book, I explain how the Anu 10,000 years ago had a great civilization and had left us many inscriptions. See, as I told you, if you keep waiting for the Europeans to tell you our entire history, you're never going to get our history. You see, that's what makes me so proud of Shanice. I am so proud of Sister Shanice, because Shanice is writing the whole her history. She's writing history of her people. You know, that's a bad sister. You're probably asking yourself, how did I learn about the Su Empire if I didn't obtain this knowledge from Europeans? The answer is, I learned this knowledge from a scholar who, while working on the ancient records of India, we call the Puranas, the Ramayana, and etc., discovered that these stories or textual evidence was not about India, but instead these records were about the Nile Valley. This scholar was Dr. Leni Srivanasan, in her study of the Rigveda, Purana, Pali texts of India, discovered that these texts are talking about events that took place in the Nile Valley, not in India. Dr. Srinivasan has written several books and articles and explains that the reason many locales mentioned in the Rigveda, Ramayana, and other texts are not found in India. And the reason they're not found in India is because these toponyms, these place names, come from the Nile Valley and the ancient Levant. Dr. Srinivasan has studied this ancient literature to provide us keen insight into ancient Nile Valley and the Levant history. Many people will be surprised after reading her major books, Desi, Crete to Egypt, Missing Links of the Rig Veda, and Near Eastern Deities in the Rig Veda, to learn that the Rig Veda, Ramayana, and other texts provide us information on ancient Nubia and the Dravidians in the Nile Valley. Yes, yes, yes. These books are over 300 pages long. You got to read these books in detail, but I tell you, they are so exciting, and that many of you may want to add these to your library. The Purani and Pali texts make it clear that the Chola were Kushites from Africa. The Dravidians lived in ancient Africa. It appears that the Tamil belonged to the Nyasi tribes, and the Telugu and Kannada, the Tehinu tribe. These people were called Hass, and Hasu by the ancient Egyptians. Hasu may also refer to nation or country region of Kush. First mention of the Hax goes back to Narmer, the first ruler of Egypt. Narmer was one of the first rulers to expand the Kushites into the Levant and Anatolia, invested in Egyptian and Kent in Egypt and Canaan. Many Shariks of Narmer have been found in Tel Iran, Arad, Inbisur, Alif Terence, and Nihal Tala. We know that Narmer was probably a Kushite because of a clay bulla from Nahal Tila. The inscription on the clay bulla can be read as Hast, he who belongs to Kush, or the Kushite. We know about the Sioux Empire as a result of the research of Leni Srivanasan. The Sioux Empire was dominated by Hoxas. The Hoxas were a mixed population of people from Lower Egypt, across into Libya, into the Levant. As mentioned earlier, this part of Africa was dominated by Mandi people. The Hoxas were Kushites. Kush was called by many names by the Egyptians in addition to Kush. Thus, the Kush was called Nehas and He. He was also the name of the serpent god. In the Rig Veda and other ancient Indian texts about the Nile Valley, the answer, according to Dr. Leni Srivanasan, is yes, yes, yes. These texts are about the Nile Valley, not India. The Rig Veda provides considerable information on the Sioux Empire of Nubia and Anatolia. The Dravidian speakers belonged to the Kushite Confederation. The term Kushite was a generic term for the tribes that belonged to the Confederation. Dr. Srinivasan notes that the Nile Valley Kush was called Kushadvipa, or Kush. In the Puranas, it was called Kushnila in Pali texts. The Puranas and Pali are the names given to ancient Vedic Indian texts. In the Puranas, Kusha was southern Nubia or upper Kush. In the Purana, northern Nubia or lower Kush was called Kunch. Here you can see a map where we see Kunch, and we see Kusha. The meaning of Kush has to be Kush, because why would the Hoxas kings refer to themselves as foreign kings? They were native to the land they ruled. There are Egyptian texts where the Hoxas call themselves Hash, Kushite. The Egyptian textual evidence include the primary evidence of the Turin Royal Canon, where the Hoxas were styled Hekahatsut, the same name they called the other Kushites in Nubia. During the Old Kingdom, during the New Kingdom, the Cushites were being called Hush, the same name as the Hadians called themselves, i.e. Hushka. The first four rulers of the Hyksos called themselves Hakahatsu, Hatsu, on their seals, and a monumental door jab from Avaris. This is primary contemporaneous ancient Egyptian literature, epigraphic evidence, documentation, indicating that they called themselves Hush. The Hyksos worshiped Ra and Seth. They also continued to worship Near Eastern gods and the culture of the Cushites in Temek. Temek is the name of Lower Egypt. What we call Lower Egypt, the Egyptians called that area Temek. Research by C. Stantis and H. Korowski in a paper presented at the 88th annual meeting of the American Association of Physical Anthropologists. In their paper, Migration into Egypt During the Second Intermediate Period, they observed that the ruling class may have been foreign, but the local people were native to the Lower Egypt during the Hyksos period, at Tel El Dab or Avaris, Tel El Rotaba, and Tel El Mashk Ahut, and other parts of the Delta or Temek. The latest research on the Hyksos indicates that there was no invasion of Lower Egypt. No. That is bullshit. It's a myth. And yet that's what they teach you, that that Lower Egypt was invaded by Hyksos, and that's wrong. The Hyksos always were there. Bruce Bauer, 2019, admits that there are no place in Lower Egypt that indicates any battles being fought in the region before and during the Hyksos period. Moreover, the archaeological evidence makes it clear that the Lower Egyptians and people in Libya and the Middle East practiced the same culture. They also had strong relations with the Cushites and Nubia. This is not surprising because Lower Egypt, Libya, and the Levant made up Temek, which since the Unna inscription dating to the Old Kingdom was Hust, or Kush. The Hyksos ruled from 1650 to 1550. The New Kingdom lasted from 1549 to 1292. During the New Kingdom, Egyptians used the name as a generic term for the Asians. The term Habiru was an ethnonym for one of the Asian tribes. It is clear that the Habiru and Hekihasu were the same people. They would have had the same name, given the fact the New Kingdom began at the end of the Hakahasu dynasty. These are some of the Haka signs. These are some of the scarabs that the various, rulers of Lower Egypt left, the so-called Hyksos, or Hast. And so originally the name Kush was not Kush, it was Hasht. Hyksos kings were proud of their Kushite origin. In the Hyksos seals, the kings wrote the names followed by the Hakahasu, king of the Kushites. These sealers are primary contemporaneous evidence that these people, in a sense, were Kushites. In summary, the meaning Hast is Kushite. My interpretation of N25 Hast is supported by classical scholars. Line 46 of the Weni or Unna inscription and Sahure, he was a pharaoh of Egypt, and the use of the term Hast on the Hyksos ceilings and inscriptions generally. Apophis maintained the tradition of the Egyptians during his rule. He's supposed to be a Hyksos king. He is credited with encouraging his scribes to copy priceless Egyptian texts, including the Edwin Smith Surgical Papyrus, the oldest known surgical handbook, the Rhine Mathematical Papyrus, which explained Egyptian mathematical theory, and the Westcar Papyrus. These texts would have been lost to mankind except for the foresight of Pharaoh Apophis. The Nahisi, or Segru people, began to settle Kush around 2200 BC. The kings of Kush had their capital at Kerma in Dongola and a sedentary center on Sai Island. The same pottery found at Kerma is also present in Libya, especially the Fezzan. The name Hasti for the Hurrian comes from their name in Kush. This results from the fact that Hasti corresponds to Hastia or Tasedi, the name of the Kushite nation, Tasedi. In summary, the meaning of Hush is Cushite. My interpretation of N25 Haas is supported by the Winnie or Union scripture. If you look over here on the right hand side, you can see the Winnie inscription. And the Winnie inscription is where they talk about the Wawat, the Magi, Yom, you know, and that these, in a sense, were not just place names, they were also the names of different people. On that map that is next to the Winnie inscription, you can see what they said some of the basic areas was, you know, the basic areas that were mentioned. The original Sioux Empire was founded by the Yanu. The second Sioux Empire was founded by the Sioux. It is important to remember that the Mandi people inhabited the Nile Valley, Libya, and the Levant. The Mandi had established colonies not only in the Nile Valley and the Levant, but also in Mesopotamia and, yes, even China. This is old Philae Island, and this is in a sense where the center of the Sioux Empire was situated. The center of the Sioux Empire was in the Upper Egypt and Kush. The area from Elephantine to Philae was called Noon. Over time, the Sioux Empire migrated into Cameroon and Chad. I think I read somewhere they found, they've even found some Egyptian artifacts as far away as the Congo. The Mandi speakers include the Maninka, the Mandinka, the Saninka, the Bambara, the Kapeli, the Jula, the Bozo, the Mende, the Susu, and the Bai. There are around 60 to 75 languages spoken by 30 to 40 million people belonging to the various Mandi speakers. Today, they live chiefly in Burkina Faso, Mali, Senegal, Gambia, Guinea-Bissau, Sierra Leone, Liberia, Ivory Coast, Mauritania, Ghana, and also in northwestern Nigeria and northern Benin. Okay, if you look on the left-hand side, you can see the city of Garama. This was a city in Libya. The top picture is the city of Garama. And this is an outline of the city and some of the monuments from there. They also built pyramids. And these were built by the Mandinka people. The reason they called their civilization Garama is because Garama comes from the name the dry land or the hot land Mandi. And then the bottom picture on the left-hand side, that's from the site of Mendi in Egypt. And Mendi was probably a major area where many of the Mandi speakers lived in Egypt. Because as I've told you before on some of my earlier presentations, is that Egypt was not a monolithic society. Egypt was a Pan-African society. And as a result, you had people like Wolof, various Bantu tribes, and other people that lived in ancient Egypt. And they lived in the various sipats, or the various city states or counties. And so then Egypt, and that's why the Egyptian language, Medinetra, is in a sense a cosmopolitan language, but Medinetra was in a sense a lingua franca. That's why you can find the Medinetra related to the Bantu, Medinetra, related to the Bantu languages, Wolof, you know, and other West African languages, because after the fall of Egypt, many of the Egyptians migrated to West Africa. It's important to remember that the Mandi people inhabited the Nile Valley, Libya, and Levant. The Mandi had established colonies not only in Levant, but also in China. And this is, you can see, this is from Elephantine. On the right-hand side, the top, we see more of the various, inscriptions that these kings left from the Sioux Empire. And then we can see one of the Sioux temples in Egypt that was on Elephantine or the island of Philae. An early king of Sioux was Sheshe. Sheshe ruled for 19 years. It appears that his authority extended to the Hyksos in Lower Egypt. Sheshe was married to a Nubian named Tadi. Their son was named Nahisi. After Sheshe's death, the throne was given over to Pharaoh Nahisi, or Asahir. The theocratic center of Sioux were Philae Umbo. The texts of Nahisi have been found in Nubati, Gazdi, Kazi, Mendes, and Sais. The capital of the Sioux was Umbo. Here's a picture of, you notice, we can see in a sense, one of the Sioux temples. And we can also see one of the major kings of the Sioux. And this is a picture of Nahisi. This pyramid and lion figure. Here's Umbo. Umbo was also in the Nile Valley, and this was another center where the Sioux kings, in a sense, had control over, and where many of the Sioux leaders were educated at Umbo. The Sioux people worshipped a number of gods, including Set, Neith, and Benindian. Benindian was a unifying god for the Sioux, because this god was the spirit of Geb, Osiris, Re-Ra, and Shu. The major center of Benindian worship was Mendes. Philae was the symbolic seat of the Cushite high god. Okay, if you look at the pictures on the right-hand side, the first image is the goddess Neith, and then further to the right, we find the god, Benibdien. And these were the principal gods worshipped by the Sioux people. And in fact, Neith continued to be worshipped by many Mandi-speaking people all the way up until the introduction of Islam into West Africa. And Neith was also a popular god among the so-called Minoans or Cretans. The most famous king of the Second Sioux Empire was Nahisi. King Nahisi was the son of Sheshi. Nahisi was a 14th century dynasty king of Egypt. You know, they get them all mixed up, and so they get different time periods, different dynasties. But what we do know is that Nahisi was, in a sense, according to the Indian literature, he was one of the major kings of the Sioux Empire. The throne name of Nahisi was Ahseri. Stelas of Nahisi have been found in Tel El Merdan, Tel Hubua, Tel El Dabal, Taraji. Nahisi made many offerings to Benibdiet, the god Benibdiet. This is some of the inscriptions or names of Nahisi. Nahisi was loved by people from Kush to Canaan. Dr. Srivinivasan makes it clear that Nahisi was a Sioux. Srivinivasan made clear Nahisi was called Nahusha in the Indian inscriptions. So whenever you read, in a sense, Nahusha in the various Indian literature, they're talking about the king of Sioux called Nahisi. And canon of today, many people are very much interested in canon because they call that, in a sense, the promised land of the Holy Land. The leaders of the Sioux Empire were predominantly Mandi-speaking people. Their name Sioux came from the Mandi word Si, and the word Si meant black people and nation, race, ethnicity, and all that. Thus, the addition of a U to Sioux made the plural gives us the word Sioux, you see. And so then the people of Sioux, or the black people, you see, they were centered at Umbo. And see, I think one of the things that, one of the reasons why I think that the people of Sioux didn't really find that much difference is that remember that the word Kamitru, that means, in a sense, black people and nation. And so the Mandingo word was a continuation of that whole idea of the chosen people of God who were black. They were also a nation. And that's why they took the word see, added U to it and became Sioux. And that's why they probably didn't see too much difference and call themselves Kamedians or the people of Sioux. The Xia civilization of China and the Lam were part of the Sioux Confederation. The Sioux founded and belonged to Sioux and the Lam nations were Mandi speakers. Again, we get the word Si, add the U, Sioux, to make it plural. The Sioux civilization fell into decline. B.G. Fanso in Cameroon History for Secondary Schools and Colleges claimed that the Sioux civilization that existed by the Shari River south of Lake Chad is descended from the Hoxas, or the original Sioux Empire. This may be true given the fact that Sioux and Seoul sound similar. The Sioux civilization was an ancient culture located in Central Africa in an area which lies in Cameroon and Chad. The Sioux people settled along the Shari River, which is located to the south of Lake Chad. The modern Katoka people, an ethnic group located in Cameroon, Chad, and Nigeria, claim ethnic descent from the ancient Soul. They claim the Soul were a race of giants. According to their tradition, the Soul were a race of giants that used to inhabit the area to the south of Lake Chad, between the northern regions of both Nigeria and Cameroon. The term Soul was likely to have first been introduced into the written sources during the 16th century AD by Ahmed ibn Fertu in his two chronicles, the Book of the Bornu Wars and the Book of the Kanem Wars. The Grand Imam of the Bornu Empire was Ahmed ibn Fertu. He described the military expeditions of King Idris Aluma of Borno. Those populations that were conquered and vanquished by Idris Aluma were referred to as the Soul. The Soul did not speak the Kanuri language. The Soul civilization existed from the 6th century BC to the 16th century AD. The Bornu Empire took control of the lands formerly ruled by the Soul. In summary, the Soul Empire extended from the Nile Valley to China. You got to get my new book. You can get it on Amazon.com. You got to get this book if you want to get a detailed understanding of the ancient Sioux Empire. This book is on Amazon.com. You can get the book as a hardback. You can get it as a Kindle book, or you can get it as a paperback book. But you need to get this book if you want to know a detailed history of the Sioux Empire. Get this book, History of the Sioux Empire. And this book explained that the center of the Sioux Empire was in Upper Egypt and Kush, the area from Elephantine to Philae that was called Nun. In History of the Sioux Empire, you will learn that the Mandi people formerly inhabited the Nile Valley, Libya, and the Levant. You'll read about the archaeological, epigraphic, and linguistic evidence confirming that the Mandi-speaking people established colonies not only in the Levant, but also Mesopotamian China. Get this book, History of the Sioux Empire. This is a book that tells you the history of an Egyptian empire that was not in a sense a dysfunctional empire. You see, they always tell you that the intermediate period, second intermediate period, was the breakup of Egypt. In a way, it was not entirely a breakup of Egypt. What it was is that during the intermediate period, it was when the Kushites of Lower Egypt, Tamek, Hoxus, it was when these Kushites of Lower Egypt took over the Egyptian dynasties. And that's why many of these pharaohs, in a sense, they were just returning to the original Kushite civilization that was first founded in Egypt by Narmer, or Menes, the first king of Egypt, the first person to unify Egypt. Get this book, History of the Sioux Empire, so you can learn about this interesting, great civilization. Okay, again, if you want to find out more about Blacks in the Nile Valley, you want to get my book, The World History of the Black Race. This book will tell you about all the various Black civilizations throughout, in a sense, the world. Get Nile Valley History in the Rig Veda. When you read my book, Nile Valley History in the Rig Veda, it gives you a detailed discussion of much of the literature written by Lenny Srinivasan that talks about, in a sense, that Nile Valley was really the origin of Indian civilization. But this only talks about her work on the Indian documents, the Puranas, the Pali, the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, you see. But this book, Nile Valley History in the Rig Veda, it will tell you about that. Get these books if you want to get a more systematic and greater understanding of the history of Egypt. History was not just a center of civilization for people in Africa. It was a center of civilization that these people took their civilization and spread it to India, spread it to Mesopotamia, even spread it to China. You see? And then finally, you want to get my book, The Dawn of Writing, Decipherment of the Night, Dispello Tablets. from Göbekli Tepe Pillars. In this book, I talk about the writing of the Anu back around up to the Younger Dryas. And I'm still trying to get more information so I can come out with a book, a full discussion of the historical period in which the Anu ruled the world. Again, a lot of this stuff is mainly in inscriptions, some archaeological evidence, but one day I want to get that book out. But if you want to find out some aspects of this great Anu civilization that existed 14, 20,000 years ago, you want to get the book, The Dawn of Writing, Decipherment of the Thinite Inscription. What is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry, or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. Please join my Patreon, and these slides are going to be on my Patreon. And join my Patreon so you can see the slides and get other information. Thank you.
Absolutely incredible. Absolutely incredible community. This is why we do what we do. This is why I am so blessed and honored that Dr. Winters said yes to me to come onto the platform to develop this relationship and to be able to teach on a basically a weekly basis, only missing three shows, two of them my fault, one of them on him. For the last 2 years. And we're looking at a scholar that, let me ask you something, Doc, because you always talk about, and you've proven this, that, you know, you don't have to have a PhD to do research. Is that right?
Yes.
Do you have to go to Africa to know how to research Africa?
No. they took all the monuments and everything else.
Now, let me ask you, I don't know this. Have you ever been to Africa? Because I have not.
No, I had too many kids. I had to.
Exactly.
Get my beautiful.
So you're helping me make my case in point. Now, all of you who are Egypt drunk in denial. Oh, I got to go to Africa. Oh, I got to set foot on the land. All I got to do. Yep, that's great if you can do that. But the majority of us, for whatever reason, don't have the money, they got too many kids, too much, not enough time. You can't. Africa is in you. It's in us. We are Africa. We are the motherland. Before it was named Africa, we are that first frequency. We are the firstborn of the firstborn.
Right.
Do you understand what he said? You are the firstborn of the, we are the firstborn of the firstborn.
Yeah. And see, you know, and that's the whole point is that just a couple of weeks ago, I know Dr. Greg Carr, he took about a couple hundred people over to Egypt. They had a beautiful trip around Egypt. They got to see many other temples. They were inspired and people gave them lectures. But they just went into the temples to really get the research and copied all the damn inscriptions down just about.
Right.
They took just about all the artifacts.
They raped the land.
Yeah, they raped the land. They took the obelisks and all that. Yes, there's new research every day. But that new research, they're not going to let a nigga on those sites.
Nope.
You know?
Nope.
They're not going to even let you into the, you can go to the Oriental Institute. They're not going to let your black ass into the basement where they got the good shit. Right. You can go to the Natural History Museum in Chicago. They're not letting you in the basement. White folks, second frequency, they guard that shit religiously.
Yep.
They guard
with their lives, literally.
And so that's why, in a sense, you have to study the literature. You have to learn the languages, though. You have to learn the languages.
Yeah, linguistics.
For me to do my research.
Do you know, I don't want to spill all the tea. But I did a test with one of our goddesses that's very well known in the community. And did you know that there are AI systems? First of all, there's over 2,000 languages in Africa.
Yeah.
You can learn any language anywhere in the world on your cell phone, on your device right now.
Right.
There's no excuse, family. There's no. This is a new day and new dawn of a new age. There is no excuse. So, you know, linguistically, I'm, you know, that's one of the next things. That's my goal for next year. Next year, like Dr. Winters, I want to learn a new language. So I'm going to spend the entire year next year learning a language. Then I'm going to ask, I haven't asked you, but I'm going to ask you, what language should I learn? But I had a goddess who came onto the platform and I was doing a training with. I showed her how she could take her website or her books and how she can translate them into any language.
Yeah.
If you want to translate it into Yoruba, Kiswahili, Pidgin, whatever the language is, we now have that right here on this device, right here. And what I'm going to tell the community, if you don't do this work, it ain't on us.
Yeah.
Don't sit up and bitch and moan about, oh, woe is me. It's on you. Because yeah, now there's no excuse.
See, back in the day, I had to buy records. I had to get tapes like at the University of Illinois, when I graduated in 1973, I made sure we used to have an anthropological lab.
Yeah.
And the anthropological lab at that time, they had all these different languages and they had all these papers. See, a lot of people who would work on their PhD and master's degrees, they would have files, their papers would be on file.
I had to
re-record Tamil, Telugu, and Chinese and other languages. I put them on tape. Then after I left university, I bought records. I had to buy books because, see, I wanted to just get a reading knowledge of the language. Knowledge of the language because the fact that at that time you had area studies. And in area studies, you had to learn the place. You had to learn about the place anthropologically, you know, politically, sociologically. And then you also had to learn the language. See, back in the day, you couldn't get a master's degree at Illinois, University of Illinois. You couldn't get a master's degree unless you had a reading knowledge of a foreign language.
Now,
you know, it's all about money. So they don't, you know, it's all about hustling money. It's like when I got my PhD, at Loyola, it was about 20 or 30 of us. Maybe a few more. And these were getting PhDs in every department. Mine in educational psychology. Others getting them in anthropology. You know, all of them. But there were people getting an educational doctorate or an ED. There's about 300 of them. when you get an ED, you become part of a cohort. And then your cohort would work together as a group, and then you would get your ED, your educational doctorate. But see, a PhD, very few people got the PhD. But the thing, what I'm saying is this, is that the difference between an ED and a PhD is I had to do completely original research, whereas an ED, you could do some research, you could do a little paper, anything, and that was it. But a PhD, you had to do original research, something that was original. Like when you did your paper, they told you you couldn't do your master shit. Hell no.
They said
do something completely new. That's
right.
The difference between writing a dissertation and just a paper or a thesis.
That's right. The rest of my hair fell out on that shit. I swear to God.
Well, it went to your beard. That's all.
That's where it fell down here. Oh, that scared the shit out of me. I was like, what?
So that's why I told you that it's all in knowing what you're doing, and that's why I'm so proud of the people who took my class.
Yes.
You made me teach the class because I wasn't going to teach it.
I know you weren't.
And the thing is this: I'm so happy to see so many of the people who took my class that are writing books, writing articles, and they're being more productive in a scholarship manner than people with PhDs from Harvard.
From Harvard. Yeah. I love it and when you Harvard. Do that.
and Temple University, which is amazing. Right. And I'm so proud of that. And that, and family, I'm gonna tell you out there that, as I told you before, you got so much out there, family, and so much knowledge that you got that you need to share with us. And so you got to take the time to Absolutely. Sit down and put that knowledge on paper. You right. see,
you don't need a PhD, you don't need a GED. What you need is AMA. Yeah. That's what you need.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what you need.
AMA. You got to deal with AMA because, see, AMA can give you things. I remember back in the day, I would want to know a subject and I would pray before I went to sleep. And I'd have a dream. When I'd wake up, it would give me the answer.
Mm-hmm.
The direction mm-hmm. of research that I was mm-hmm. in. But as I told before, is that you know, that's why do you think people from China and all those other places come over to the United States?
Right.
Go to Harvard.
Right.
Go to, in a sense, University of Chicago. They don't go to every place now.
Yeah.
They go to Harvard, University of Chicago, University of Pennsylvania, UC, Yale, Stanford, because they got in those libraries. When I was doing research.
And you know, Africans, it's so funny when we're talking about language, because it's something I've always feared. But a lot of my clients are Africans, or you know, from the continent, and the average African, and I'm saying average, not you know, just like not necessarily highly educated even or formally educated, speak five different languages off the bat.
Yeah.
And but unfortunately, you're considered illiterate if you don't speak English. But they just the kids. Speak 5-6 different languages.
That's because we didn't have to learn it. We didn't have to learn a foreign language. I mean, look how many of us. Look how many of us.
And all the lingua francas that came from from Africa as well.
Yeah, a lot of them, you know. And
yeah, man.
But the thing that makes it so wonderful is that it's easy to learn languages now. I had to get tapes. I had to get books.
Yeah.
I had to spend a lot of money. Whereas now, like you said, you can just use your phone. And but the thing is this is that's why you have all these imposters. You have all these imposters today that are making you think that they're scholars because they just took a trip to Africa. I'm talking about the white ones too.
Take a trip
to Africa, and then they come back. Oh, they're African expert.
Took a couple of photos.
Yeah. They went to China and they're expert. Or they went to Latin America, they're a Latin American expert. They haven't done any original research. They haven't looked at the documents. They haven't even talked to the people. But they just took a visit over there. That's why certain people, I'm not going to say who they are, I get in trouble. That's why certain people dominate every field because they had the money to go and travel. And when they traveled over there, they came back and then they became the expert, you see.
Yep.
And they don't, and they don't fish. That's why America's all fucked up today.
Yeah.
You know, that's why Biden got all these people from Yale and Harvard around him, and he had ruined America. He took the damn Russian money. No, America's supposed to be a laissez-faire country, a laissez-faire in business. I mean, you can do whatever you wish.
Mm-hmm.
Even during World War II, the Germans, they sent the dividends that they earned off their, that people earned off their stock, they sent the dividends back to America.
Mm.
People owned stock in German factories during World War II.
Wow.
Biden kept the Russians gold. Well, he tried to keep that $200 million, but somehow they said that the Russians got their money, probably because those banks, they didn't want to be messed up. But he held back $200 million of the rush. $200 billion. $200 million to $200 billion of the rush.
It has to be billion. Yeah.
And they took their gold. And now you know what's happening. Saudi Arabia, in a sense, they in a sense made the petrodollar. In other words, the only way you could buy, only way you could buy oil was to spend dollar bills. Biden, he told the Saudi Arabians, well, we're going to make the Russians pay $60. Everybody's going to pay $60 for a barrel of oil. A barrel of oil costs $99. But Biden, we're going to make it so everybody had to pay $60. What did Saudi Arabia say? They said, fuck you. And now the Saudi Arabians is telling the Chinese who spend billions of dollars on gas, you don't have to have American dollars. We'll take your yuan.
Well, that's why they got rid of Gaddafi, right?
Yeah, because he was going to take over the dollar. But we didn't have, but Biden done it all by himself. Mm-hmm. Now the Chinese are selling back. You know, we live off.
This is the fall of an empire. You talked about the Roman Empire, what it looks like. This is part of that. This is what it looks like.
But who would have thought one man, Biden, everybody just knew that Trump was going to destroy America. Right. But who would have ever thought that Biden, by him holding back that money from Russia, holding the Russians' gold, now every country trying to get their gold out of America.
Yeah.
You know, China.
It's crazy. China, but with the white ones, it's a damned if you do, damned if you don't.
Well, see,
it's a lesser of two evils. None of them are any good. It don't matter who's in office. But yeah, it's like, and you know, of course, hey, go vote Democrat. You know, but it's stupid, man. It's stupid.
Yeah. And then, but see, here's the whole point though: is that they got those people who all they think about is money to run to listen to. Instead of in the old days, I told you many times, family. In the old days, they used to keep a nigga in the closet.
They don't have anybody to know history.
And before the old white heads would do anything, they'd go ask that nigga in the closet, do you think we should do this?
Mm-hmm.
And people would say yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
They got rid of all the old white heads. When old white heads got fired, they had to take their nigga in the closet with them. Mm-hmm. Now America is ran by people that all went to Harvard and Yale.
Don't know their history, don't know and don't have a brother who knows the history to be able to give them the right advice.
And not only that, but see, most of the people who went to Harvard and Yale, their families had money. They didn't know shit.
Right, they didn't. That's what I'm saying. They didn't know their history.
Yeah.
They had no idea.
And so
they're operating on hubris. They're trying to protect what they have, understanding the history of how did these empires fall.
Just like, America said that Biden said that the American businesses they can't do trade with China. Now Intel lost $100 billion.
Wow, what?
They can't sell their chips to China.
Are you serious right now?
Yes. And then why do you think so many people been laid off from the tech industry?
Yes.
Anybody tell that? That's because Biden said you can't trade with China. But then, just like Trump, he put sanctions on China.
Right, I remember that.
Sanctions on China. That means we had to pay more for Chinese goods, and all the goods you buy at Walmart are made in China.
Yep.
So therefore, when they put the sanctions on China, the Chinese didn't pay. You and I pay. I was at Walmart today. The Chinese, they run me. They running me at Walmart because that's what.
They run me at Costco, Walmart, Costco. And Amazon. Man, that's they got that. Them white boys got me. Oh, they got me.
But it's all for China. Biden gonna let generals go on TV and say we gonna attack China in 2025. So what the Chinese, they buy back their bonds. They making America buy the bonds back. They went down from $1.3 trillion in bonds down to less than $800 million.
God damn. Wow.
$800 billion, I mean.
$800 billion, but still, what?
Yes. And China, Japan, and even the UK, they're trying to sell their bonds. Because
World War III, is not going to be a nuclear bomb.
It's already on.
It's going to be an economic
issue.
It's going to be an economic war.
Right.
That's the ones, those are the ones that are going to win. It's going to be an AI war.
Right.
Those are the ones that's going to win.
Yeah, but
the
one
who has the intelligence.
But it's worse than that because, see, in the 60s, as black people were taking over a lot of the industries, we were becoming, in a sense, the people who was working in all the major industries. Then because of the fact that we were using unions to make more money, many American businessmen said, we can make more money if we go invest in China. So the herd FBA, they took all their companies over to China. Now they backfired. I'm telling you, family.
Yep.
I'm telling you, family. Every time they try to do something to us, it backfires. It backfires
so true,
on them.
So
just like right now, they want to make it so that Fannie Willis or whatever name is in Atlanta, she can prosecute the rappers, black millionaires, put them in jail. Now she's using the same laws to prosecute they demagogue Trump.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you.
Yep.
It always backfires. Always backfires. Everything they try to do to us, Amma and his greatness, Amma and his wisdom, he makes sure in a sense that it backfires on them. You
Absolutely.
See that McConnell, he's freezing after 30 seconds. Reverend Matthews, if you see me freezing, please cover for me. Lock it down.
What?
Yeah.
What? What happened there? What happened?
I froze!
Oh, no, don't freeze.
No, McConnell, he freezing.
You ain't right.
See, and see, these people don't understand. The world don't understand is that second frequency in America, they will destroy themselves just to hurt us.
Yes.
And they don't
I don't think people really realize that, man.
Yeah. But
I really don't.
But we always find a way to. What do you always say? What happens to black people? We don't die.
We multiply.
That's right. Because we're always thinking. We're always thinking.
We're figuring shit out and figuring a way out. Always.
A
way around it. If we can't go through it, we'll go around it. If we can't go around it, we'll go over it. If we can't go over it, we'll go under it.
That's right. Like they're trying to bring down inflation. How are you going to bring down inflation if you're giving over $150 billion to Ukraine to fight a war?
Why are
they doing that? They're doing that because the people in Congress, they own all of those military stock. And they want to keep getting the dividends. And see,
right.
It is a shame. As I told you before, it's a shame that we will sell our brothers and sisters in America. Why are you saying we, Clyde? I'm stuck over here, so I say we. But that doesn't mean I agree. But we all part of this place.
Right. We all have history. This is our place. A history, epigenetic, genetic memory of it. Absolutely.
Yeah. And see, and that's the whole point. And so what can you do with the psychopaths? That's why they want to come out and kill us. They wanted to kill us in Jacksonville. They wanted to kill those people last year in New York, Syracuse or somewhere.
Yep.
I think it was Syracuse, one of those cities. But the whole point is that.
Oh, Buffalo.
Buffalo. But just look at this. Montgomery showed you that, yes, second frequency, you can believe whatever you want, but there's still brothers and sisters who will fight for the right.
Absolutely.
Of the white chair, baby.
That's right.
White chair.
That's right. Used to be the time when we were coming up, don't make me get up out of my chair. Now it's like, don't make me get my chair.
Yes,
family,
sir.
It is that time where we give honks and we give thanks for this great scholar, this great man, this great Amma in expression, this Amma with bones right here in front of us that gave us another civilization. Not just Kemet. Now we have the Sioux Empire. Oh my gosh. What? This is unprecedented. And I'm humbled by the presence of this great researcher and scholar that we call Dr. Clyde Winters. But he's more than that. You know what I'm saying? He's more than that. He is a true conduit of Ama. And we give onks to Ama and the ancestors for bringing this man to our lives and for us being able to see him. To be able to see a Dr. Clyde Winters means that you are able to see yourself. You see yourself in the data. You know that you are the one and the all. You know that you represent this allness we call Ama. You know that the living ancestors are in you, alive, giving us guidance, giving us the ability to come here every week and know that we know that we know. And so in the name and the nature and the consciousness of Ama, we say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
So it is.
All right, family, I love you. I love you, Dr. Winters. I love you, Ama. Thank you so much for being here, family. We're getting ready to change this thing. We're getting ready to do something that's never been done before. It's time for our people to boldly go where no white and no third or second or fourth frequency has